Greetings, everyone. This is Nathan Cherry, and this is the Silk Road History Podcast. On this episode of the SRHP, we pick up where we left off last time in this second installment of the History of the Uyghurs, which will take us from the dusty deeps of history to the rise of Yaqub Beg in 1872. Stay tuned. It's been a while, almost two whole months, since the last SRHP episode, The History of the Uyghurs, Part 1. Let's just say that I bit off a little bit more than I could chew. Originally, I was going to knock out The History of the Uyghurs in just one part. Then I decided to make it two parts, and now, my friends, I admit defeat. To tell the story of the Uyghurs with the requisite depth and rigor that I'd like, I'll be making two more installments in what will now be a four-part History of the Uyghurs series. Otherwise, this episode would have gone on for 2.5 hours, if not longer. And although that might not bother me too much, I have to think of my audience. Everyone likes a big slice of chocolate cake, but too much richness and decadence can make you sick, and it's ditto with history podcasts. So in order to keep things a bit lighter and to prevent you from reaching for the Pepto-Bismol, I'm going to break up what would have been the History of the Uyghurs Part 2 into 3. Parts 2, 3, and 4. This episode, Part 2, will cover the Qing conquest of Xinjiang all the way to 1872, when Yaqub Beg established his emirate in Xinjiang. Now, make no mistake, this is still a huge amount of ground to cover, but it's a bit less ground than going from 1755 to 2018. Part 3 will cover 1872 to 1949, dealing mostly with the rise of Uyghur nationalism and ending with the rise of the People's Republic of China in 1949. The final episode will cover 1949 to 2018, modern Uyghur history. And I think that's a nice demarcation. It's just all a bit cleaner. And just like last time, there will be a list of terms, a timeline, and maps posted along with this episode on the SRHP website at www.thesilkroadhistorypodcast.com. So be sure to check that out if you're ever confused or need a wee bit of orientation during this episode. And for those who did not see my tweet or my note on the website, I'd like to make a quick correction. Last episode, I said that Chinggis or Genghis Khan died in 1260. Well, I was off about 40 years. He actually died in August of 1227. Don't know how exactly that happened, but with so many names and dates being flung around, it can be hard to keep up sometimes. So I do apologize once again for that. But with all that said and done, let's return once again to the ancient tracks of the Silk Road and to our history of the Uyghurs. We left the protagonists of our story last around the 15th-16th century CE. The Uyghur kingdom of Kochou had fallen in the mid-14th century, and thereafter Buddhism was gradually superseded along the Silk Road by Islam, and the Uyghur identity gradually faded from memory. The people who had been the Uyghurs mixed and melded with the great panoply of cultures in the Tarim Basin, and the peoples who succeeded them rather allied their identities with the oases around which they lived, knowing themselves as Turki, or Musulman, or Altishari. But never Uyghur. Nobody that we'll be talking about in this episode will have referred to themselves as Uyghurs, and so I won't either. I'll be calling them Altisharis, Turks, Kashgaris, or even just locals of the region. But make no mistake, these are the people who would come to call themselves Uyghurs, and so the history we'll be covering here is indeed Uyghur history. In order to bring us back up to speed, we'll need to wind forward the clock around 300 years. Now, for around 200 years, the Khans of the Mongol Eastern Chagatai Khanate, also known as Mogulistan, had ruled in the Tarim Basin. But their hegemony over the region buckled under pressure from the Kyrgyz and Kazakhs to the west, and internal conflict from within. Local rulers of the oases were often difficult to control, establishing khanates of their own and declaring autonomy from their Mughal masters. And over time, a new power had arisen in the region. the Naqshbandi Sufi Hojas. If you're unfamiliar with Sufism, well, to make an incredibly long story short, let's just call it Islamic mysticism. Most religions have a branch of mysticism which delves into ultimate reality, higher states of consciousness, and the mysteries of the universe, and so on and so forth. For Judaism, it's the Kabbalah. For Christianity, it's just plain old Christian mysticism. And for Buddhism, you could maybe argue it's Tantrism. In any case, Sufism is the Islamic variation. And Naqshbandi Sufism, in contrast to the tendency of many such mystical orders to cloister and sequester themselves away from the secular world, rather advocated for the active involvement of its disciples in worldly affairs and the strict adherence to Sharia law. At some point, this Sufi order had spread to the oases of the Tarim Basin and had wielded great influence in a religious capacity. But over time, the Mongol rulers had been forced to cede secular authority to the Hojas. Then it became an oasis-by-oasis affair. One oasis might be predominantly controlled by Mongol rulers of the Duglat clan, who were vassals of the Chagatai elite, and another might be controlled by the Hojas. By the 17th century, the Hojas had achieved absolute supremacy in the Tarim Basin, and the Mughals were more or less completely neutered. But even the Hojas were not exempt from factional infighting. By the mid to late 17th century, two rival Sufi sects, the Ishaqiya, or the Black Mountain, and the Afaqiya, or the White Mountain, engaged in a struggle that was by no means holy. Ismail Khan, the ruler of the Yarkent Khanate and nominally still a vassal of the Chagatais, exiled Afaq Hoxha, leader of the White Mountain Hojas, to the west. But Afaq Hoxha wasn't having any of that, and petitioned the fifth Dalai Lama, the great fifth Lobsang Gyatso, to help him seize control of the Tarim Basin. Now you might be wondering, isn't it peculiar that a Muslim holy man asked the Buddhist holy man to aid him in a temporal military conquest? Well, back in those days, it wasn't all that out of the ordinary, and the Dalai Lamas of those times were definitely not as sweet and cuddly as our own number 14. The fifth is well remembered for engaging in a number of military enterprises in order to vouchsafe the Dalai Lamas and Tibet security, and this was no exception. The Dalai Lama wrote to Galdan, leader of the Jungar Confederacy. The Jungars were another one of those nomadic tribal confederacies, similar to the ones we talked about last episode. The Jungars were all Oirat Mongols, a group of Mongols coming from the westernmost part of Mongolia. They were comprised of the Khoros, also known as the Jungar, the Dorbet, the Khoit, and eventually the Turgut and the Koshut tribes, with the Jungars, of course, being the tribe with the most influence. Over the course of the 16th and 17th centuries, the Jungars had been slowly but surely building a steppe empire in the region that now bears their name, Jungaria, which, if you remember from our geography episode, is located just north of the Tarim Basin across the Tian Shan Mountains. The Jungars had built stout cities, established strong commercial connections in Russia's ever-expanding Siberian territories and with the newly ascendant Qing dynasty in China, and were even said to fight using mobile camel tanks, which consisted of small cannons mounted on camelback. Significantly, the Jungars had also converted to Tibetan Buddhism early in their history, and for this reason, Galdan heeded the Dalai Lama's call to arms. Over the course of 2 years, from 1678 to 1680, the Jungars conquered Kashgaria and the Tarim Basin at large, and placed Afaq Hoxha in the driver's seat, allowing him to stay so long as he let them call the shots and sent a little bit of cash their way to sweeten the deal. Some Uyghur nationalists today regard Afaq Hoxha as a traitor who sold out his people to foreign oppressors, while others regard him as a hero, a Sufi saint king who helped spread Sufism into China. Indeed, the Afaq Hoxha mausoleum, located just outside of Kashgar, is regarded as one of the holiest sites in all of Xinjiang. For the next 70 years or so, the Jungar Khanate would rule over the Tarim Basin, Jungaria, and parts of Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, the last of the great steppe empires. But almost right off the bat, the Jungars were embroiled in their first of many conflicts with Qing China. Beginning in the early to mid-17th century, the Manchus, a people from the bitterly cold forests and plains of Manchuria, rode out of the north with the aim of overthrowing the Han Chinese Ming dynasty. In June of 1644, they captured Beijing, the Ming capital, and claimed the Mandate of Heaven, their right to rule over the Middle Kingdom. By the late 17th century, the Manchu Qing dynasty under the rule of the Kangxi Emperor had fully consolidated its power, eliminating the last of the Ming loyalists in southern China and Taiwan, and making peace with the Russians in Manchuria with the Treaty of Nerchinsk in 1689. Already, the Qing had eclipsed the size of the preceding Ming dynasty. But the Kangxi Emperor was a military man through and through, and took it upon himself to fill out the empire's borders with a number of expansionist military expeditions, many of which he led himself. Galdan, the Khan of the Uyghurs, was described by Manchu chroniclers as a man who was, quote, rough and crafty and likes fighting, unquote, and who was, quote, violent and evil and addicted to wine and sex, unquote. Almost from the outset of his reign, he had engaged in a number of military campaigns to consolidate the Khanate's borders, fighting with the Khalkhas, the Kazakhs, and the Kyrgyz. Although he had made amenable overtures to the Qing, assuring them that he had no designs on their territory, his vigorous conquests had driven other nomads back into Chinese lands where they had went on to wreak havoc. This was significant enough for the Kangxi Emperor to view Galdan and his rising Khanate as a threat, and from 1687 to 1697, the Uyghurs and the Qing locked horns in a long and bitter war that would ultimately lead to Galdan's demise in the incorporation of Outer Mongolia, the territory of the modern-day nation of Mongolia, into the empire. Galdan's successor, Suerong Rabtan, would be the next to invite conflict with the Manchus when, in 1770, he invaded and occupied Tibet and deposed a pretender to the seat of the Dalai Lama. Soon the Tibetans petitioned the aid of the Manchus to rid them of the Uyghurs, and in 1720 they succeeded in expelling them from the mountain kingdom, though not without incorporating Tibet into their empire while they were in the neighborhood. The Uyghurs, therefore, were slowly but surely being surrounded by Chinese dominion. A third and very costly war broke out between the two powers in 1723 on the Qinghai Plateau, and lasted until 1732, ending inconclusively. For around two decades, things were mostly quiet between the Qing and the Uyghurs after that, but everything was shortly to come tumbling down. Like so many kingdoms throughout history have fallen, it all pivoted around a good old succession crisis. The death of Khan Galdan Sering in 1745 started it all. The whole confederation was in an upheaval. A succession of candidates came to the fore, but each one was knocked out of line. Finally, in 1752, things came to a head. Amorsana and Dawachi, two Uyghur chieftains, banded together to assassinate the candidate to the succession at the time, whose name, unfortunately, I couldn't find. Of course, the ad hoc alliance fell apart. Dawachi declared himself Khan, and Amorsana, rightfully furious, went to war against him. But he was defeated by Dawachi, and fled east to the Qing frontier along with 20,000 loyalists. The Qing emperor at this time was Qianlong, who, as his name might imply, was not only one of the longest reigning emperors of China, but also one of the longest reigning heads of state in world history, 1735 to 1796. Qianlong? Get it? You know Nathan Cherry can simply not resist a pun when it presents itself. Anyway, smart guy. When Amorsana came knocking at China's door, along with Sering, another defeated chief of the Confederation, Qianlong rolled out the red carpet and wined and dined them in the Qing summer capital at Chengde instead of turning them away. Qianlong was, like his predecessors before him, eager to get rid of this whole Uyghur problem and saw a divided Uyghur Confederacy with leaders amenable to the Qing as the solution. And so he offered to help Amorsana seize the Uyghur throne. With their new allies in tow, the Qing marched into Uyghur lands, easily routed the beleaguered and feuding Uyghur camps, and by 1755 had pacified the region. Dawachi was captured, his fortress of Kulja, modern-day Yining, was seized, and the Qing made ready to set their plan in motion, dividing the region into four, with each Uyghur tribe having their own sphere of influence and their own Khan. Amorsana, who the Qing assumed would be loyal to them, was to be the Khan of the Khoits. But he would greatly betray their expectations. He wasn't satisfied with the title of Khan of the Khoits, and would accept nothing less than being the Khan of the whole Junggar Confederacy. Amorsana issued a memorial to that effect to the Qing court, massacred the Qing garrison at Kulja, and began to prosecute his reconquest of Junggar lands. The Qing had thought their position to be secure in 1755, and had therefore withdrawn the bulk of their troops. For the moment, they were unable to resist Amorsana's advances. And Qinlong was enraged. He circulated Amorsana's memorial around the empire, and soon a massive Qing force was marching towards Junggaria, vowing revenge and initiating one of Emperor Qianlong's 10 great campaigns. But Amorsana's rebellion was not their only problem in the West. After the Qing took Kulja in 1755, they detained two prominent brothers of the Efakia, the White Mountain Hojas. Remember those guys? Burhan ad-Din and Hoja Jahan were their names. The Manchus intended to install Burhan as their puppet in Altishar, the Tarim Basin, and offered him their aid in taking it from the Junggar rebels, which was achieved without too great of an effort. The Hojas were happy to finally shuffle off what they referred to as the Junggar yoke. During the Junggar rule of Altishar, the Muslim populace had been heavily taxed. Many had been forcibly removed to the Ili Valley and Jungaria for agricultural servitude, and they just chafed at having to kowtow to a Buddhist ruler rather than a Muslim one. But even so, the Hojas argued that they would merely be trading a Junggar yoke for a Chinese yoke. When Amorsana revolted against the Qing, Burhan raised his flag in rebellion as well, and was joined south of the Tianshan by his brother Hoja Jahan. And so the Qing were forced to wage war on two fronts, fighting oasis to oasis in the Tarim Basin, and against the Junggars in the plains of Ili, both of which were enormously costly and enormously difficult affairs. Finally, however, Qing armies took Kashgar and Yarkent, the two great seats of the Hoja's power, and the brothers fled west across the Pamirs to Badakhshan and the Ferhana Valley. But the Chinese pursued them even there, reaching as far as the city of Talas, where 1,000 years earlier the Tang dynasty had been routed by the forces of the Abbasid Caliphate. While the Qing were already overextended, with this great display of force in Central Asia, they were sending a message. Our hand reaches far. And local rulers in Ferhana heard it loud and clear. Soon afterwards, the head of Hoja Jahan and the remains of Burhan ad-Din were sent to Qing command in Altishar with the compliments of Mir Sultan Shah of Badakhshan. With the Tarim Basin and Junggaria under their control, the Qing executed a final solution to the Junggar problem. Emperor Qianlong urged his reluctant generals and commanders not only to destroy the Junggars in battle, but to execute all Junggar prisoners that they captured. And not just prisoners, but Junggar male civilians as well. In the end, a mass ethnic cleansing of the Junggars was undertaken by the Qing, in which every male Junggar of able body was killed. Women, children, and the elderly were spared, but only to serve as slaves to Manchu and other Mongol bannermen. The emperor issued this declaration to his troops in the west, quote, "Show no mercy at all to these rebels. Only the old and weak should be saved. Our previous military campaigns were too lenient. If we act as before, our troops will withdraw, and further trouble will occur. If a rebel is captured and his followers wish to surrender, he must personally come to the garrison, prostrate himself before the commander, and request surrender. If he only sends someone to request submission, it is undoubtedly a trick. Tell Sengun Jav to massacre these crafty Junggars. Do not believe what they say." Unquote. Those who spared Junggar lives were punished. Those who participated in the massacre were handsomely rewarded. Many Junggars died of smallpox, while others were forced to flee to Siberia or the neighboring Kazakh Khanate. The remaining Junggars were forcibly resettled in the Chinese interior, and the name Junggar was expunged from all records. In the end, 80% of the Junggars, between 480,000 to 600,000 people, died in the genocide, and the Junggar identity was effectively eliminated. Junggaria was almost entirely depopulated, with a contemporary writer noting that it was, quote, "an empty plain for 1,000 li, with no trace of man," unquote. This event is widely considered to be the prime example of genocide in the 18th century. By 1759, the Qing conquest of the West and the destruction of the Uyghurs was complete. This time, however, Manchu forces did not withdraw. Despite protestations on the home front that these regions, Jungaria and Altishar, were not a part of China, and that the native Turkic or Turanchi peoples were not Chinese, Qianlong remained firm. Quote, "There exists a view of China according to which non-Han people cannot become China's subjects, and their land cannot be integrated into the territory of China. This does not represent our dynasty's understanding of China, but is instead that of the earlier Han, Tang, Song, and Ming dynasties." Unquote. The Manchus were not Han Chinese themselves, of course, and so naturally the Qing administration did not assume a Han nationalist posture. Neither did they assert that these lands had always been a part of China. Indeed, there had been no real significant Chinese presence in the region for almost 1,000 years, when the Tang dynasty had spread their influence deep into Central Asia. But never had the Tang controlled as vast a territory as the Qing now commanded. Inner and outer Mongolia, Tibet and Ladakh, Manchuria, parts of Siberia, and now Jungaria and the Tarim Basin, which together had an area of 2 million square kilometers, 3 million times the size of France, and larger than the states of California, Oregon, Washington, Nevada, Montana, Arizona, and Idaho put together. These conquests were nearly unprecedented in Chinese history. And there was great anxiety in the upper echelons at the Qing court that the newly incorporated territories would hang above their heads as a kind of sword of Damocles, just waiting for the right moment to cut the purse strings and let the imperial coffers overflow. And they might have been right. The territory, which they divided into Huibu or Huijiang, Muslim land, and Junbu, Junggar land, or Xinjiang, meaning new frontier, was not at this time known for being an economic powerhouse. Jungaria was mostly steppe, and now was bereft of a populace to contribute to the economy such as it was. The Tarim Basin, with its lush oases and commercial connections with the Central Asian Khanates and Persia, was more prosperous, but not enough to justify the great cost that went into conquering and occupying it. Rather, Qianlong argued that holding these new territories, along with inner and outer Mongolia and Manchuria, and bringing them into the imperial fold, would almost completely eliminate what had been the Achilles heel of previous Chinese dynasties, invasions by non-Chinese peoples, often steppe nomads from the north and west. The Manchus themselves had toppled the Ming dynasty in that very same fashion, not to mention the Song, who had been brought low by the Jurchens and the Mongols, and also the Tang, the Sui, and the Han, all of whom had had their own problems with peoples on China's periphery. You can see their calculus here. By taking in hand the regions that had produced these hostile invaders, the entire problem could be nipped in the bud, and potential insurgency could be cracked down on as soon as it revealed itself. At least that was the idea. Mongolia, Jungaria, and the Tarim Basin could also serve as buffer zones against potential invasions by the Russians from the north or from Central Asia to the west. But the new conquests were not fully incorporated as provinces of the empire, at least not at first. Most historians describe them as something of military protectorates, or special administrative zones. The Qing military headquarters at Yili in Jungaria became the administrative center for both territories, and 40,000 troops were stationed in the region, a relatively limited number for such a vast tract of land. But that was the key to the Qing government's strategy, a loose hand rather than an iron fist. Nomadic groups in the region were divided into administrative units led by hereditary rulers called jasaks, who enjoyed a great deal of autonomy, were exempt from paying taxes, had their own courts and retainers, and were granted lands and titles by the Qing government. The Turkic people living in the oases of Altishar, on the other hand, were ruled by local Muslim officials known as Begs, who were appointed by the Qing government. So while the Chinese had ultimate authority in the region, they allowed for local styles of governments to take precedence, and for local rather than Chinese interests to set the agenda. One consequence of the Jungar genocide was the efflorescence of Turkic Muslim power in what would become the province of Xinjiang. Indeed, the seed of Uyghur nationalism, as it would be in the 20th century, was planted here. With the Jungars gone, the Turks of the Tarim Basin reigned in their native lands with near autonomy. Turkic culture and the Islamic faith was at least tolerated and at best actively promoted. Qing officials even developed close relations with Islamic clergy and judiciary, allowing them to officiate in areas where Sharia law was concerned. Local rulers who had aided the Qing during their conquest of the Tarim Basin and their campaign and genocide against the Uyghurs were handsomely rewarded, and Han Chinese were barred from settlement in the Tarim Basin. Only Han Chinese and the Chinese Hui Muslim merchants could live there, but only in small numbers. For the first time in a while, it was thought, the Altishadis had the place almost all to themselves. Not only had the Qing won, but the Turks, and in a sense Islam, had won as well. While some saw the Chinese administration of the region as just another pair of fetters, there were others who were less reluctant to embrace them. And the expansion of the Qing borders to the Pamirs had another consequence, the creation of the notion that this region, this place, was different in some way, and that it was united. Previously, the Turks of the Tarim Basin had viewed themselves as being more aligned with their Western neighbors in Central Asia. But over the course of generations, however, the sense that they were a people unique unto themselves would grow more and more compelling. The depopulated land of Jungaria was resettled, sometimes forcibly by the government. A vast wave of Han Chinese, many of them convicts, but also civilians from the northwest, in addition to other non-Han peoples, including Altishadis, were moved to this new frontier. By 1781, nearly 20,000 families from China's northwest had been moved to the region, all on the government's dime. Once they were there, they were sent to work on vast state farms called Tuntian, which had been established as a means of feeding the military and revivifying the region's moribund economy. It was during this time, shortly after the Qing conquest, that the environs of what is today the city of Urumqi, the capital of Xinjiang, would be settled. The Han settlement was known as Dihua, which would become the great financial center of the region, while the Manchu settlement was called Gongmingcheng and served as the area's administrative center. And so Urumqi, when it was first established, was a twin city, and it was not, in fact, at first a Uyghur city as much of it is today. That would come a little later on. Does all of this remind you of something? You know, Xinjiang is often called China's Wild West, and you can kind of see that here. You've got people moving west in search of a new life, frontier towns, bone-dry deserts, snow-capped mountains, lush prairies, horseback riding, swashbuckling, outlaws, lawlessness. Somebody should make a movie about this sometime. Call it a noodle western. And things were certainly about to get a little bit more wild in the West. While the system of rewarding local Muslim rulers was a hell of a lot better as a policy than the harsh imposition of colonial rule, some cracks began to appear shortly after the Qing conquest. Some of the Begs, especially the higher-ranking ones who had aided the Manchus, exorbitantly extorted their subjects. And the Manchu Amban being kind of like a governor or magistrate of the Tarim Basin named Su Cheng, was greatly reviled by the locals of Turfan. He and his sons had set up shop there and were infamous for kidnapping local Muslim women and holding them for months on end in their residence. In 1765, Su Cheng petitioned to join a caravan on its way to Beijing bearing gifts for the emperor, and forced 240 locals to serve as porters for him, dragging his and his son's voluminous baggage in the heat. Well, the locals of Turfan had had just about enough of Su Cheng, and in reply they raised their flag in rebellion. Su Cheng and his sons were promptly put to the sword. The Qing at first were sympathetic to the rebels' cause, and decided to turn a blind eye, assuming that the situation would resolve itself in due course. But the town held out for months, even after Qing forces besieged it, and rebel leaders petitioned aid from Central Asian Khanates to come and rid them of their Chinese overlords. That was when things reached a breaking point. The besieged would finally succumb to starvation, and when the rebel leaders were turned over to Manchu troops, Qianlong, embarrassed and enraged at the incident, ordered a general massacre. Over 2,000 men were executed on the spot, and 8,000 women and children deported to Jungaria, where they were enslaved. The Beg system was thenceforth reformed, with the higher-ranking Begs' privileges being limited, and Qing supervision of the Begs was increased. The Manchus had managed to quell the situation for the moment, and things remained relatively quiet for the next few years. But one thing deeply disturbed the Manchu rulers during this so-called Ush uprising, and that was the fact the rebels had asked for help from the west, from Turkestan. And this fear of Central Asian retaliation would remain in their minds for some time. When the Qing were still in the process of conquering the region, a wave of anger and alarm had spread throughout the Islamic Khanates and kingdoms bordering on Xinjiang. Whispers of holy war began to circulate, and finally Ahmad Shah, the king of Afghanistan, marshaled his forces and called for his neighbors to rally beneath his banner should the Chinese pass beyond the Pamirs. Of course, they didn't have the intention of doing so, and Ahmad Shah's united front never materialized. But anxiety and suspicion still reigned supreme both on the side of the Manchus and the Central Asian potentates. And it was indeed from Central Asia that the next great threat to Chinese rule would emerge. The Khanate of Kokand in the Ferhana Valley, so right over the mountains from the Western Tarim Basin, had begun to lean heavily on the Chinese. They had profited mightily from the Manchus getting rid of the Junggars because the Junggars had always been more well-suited militarily speaking than the Kokandis and were pesky middlemen between them and the largesse of China. With them gone, Kokand could trade with the Qing at will. And they got an even better deal when, from 1785 to 1792, the Qing closed trade in towns along the Mongolian-Russian border, key stops along the Siberian route, a trade route that conveyed Chinese goods from Beijing all the way across the Russian interior to Moscow. The Kokandis, though, with their lively trade with the Qing, were quick to swoop in and provide the supply for the Russian demand for Chinese tea and rhubarb. The Kokandis were constantly nagging the Manchus for expanded commercial privileges and, shockingly, had the temerity to refer to the Qing emperor as friend rather than using the tried-and-true kowtowing honorifics that were typically employed by most all Asian rulers in their letters to the Chinese court. If you're at all familiar with imperial Chinese customs, you'll know this was a huge no-no. The McCartney Embassy, the first British diplomatic mission to China in 1792, nearly caused a scandal because Lord McCartney, the British ambassador, refused to take part in the ceremonies and rituals that were customary for every foreign dignitary during an audience with the Chinese emperor. And the McCartney mission went on to fail in most of its main objectives. Great Britain, though, lay on the far side of the world, while Kokand was little more than a hop, skip, and a jump from Kashgar. Kashgari translators who received the Kokandi missives, however, were quick to omit the offending passages. How, you might be wondering, could the Kokandis act with such bravado towards the Chinese? Well, they had one trump card. Remember the White Mountain Hojas, also known as the Afaki Hojas or the Afakia? Their descendants lived on in Kokand, enjoying quite the cordial relationship with the government of Kokand and still entertaining a large following both in Kokand and Altishar, especially in Kashgar and Yarkand. Well, the Qing treasury positively clenched its cheeks at the thought of the White Mountain Hojas streaming over the mountains and causing mayhem in the Tarim Basin. And they had a right to be fearful, because the Afakis were more than willing to do exactly that. They had just one problem, though. Money, or the lack thereof. As early as the 1780s, a mere 20 years after the Qing conquest, the White Mountain had already started to raise money and cultivate the sympathies of their Kokandi hosts, as well as their contacts in Kashgar. By 1820, Jahangir Hoja, the grandson of Burhanuddin, one of the Hojas who had fought against the initial Qing invasion, rallied a force of Kyrgyz mountain men and launched a raid into Chinese territory. But against his expectations, the locals didn't rise to the occasion, and Qing forces gave him a sound walloping that sent him limping back to Kokand, where the government placed him under house arrest to keep the Chinese off their backs. 2 years later, though, in 1822, an earthquake convulsed the Ferhana Valley, damaging and destroying a number of cities and towns in the region and handing Jahangir the perfect opportunity to escape from captivity. He escaped to the wilderness and gradually gathered a following once more. In 1825, he launched yet another failed raid, only this time he wasn't captured. In the mountains outside of Kashgar, he established his headquarters and maintained close relations with the Faki loyalists in the city, who in secret sent him money and material to expand his rebellion. In 1826, Jahangir finally assembled a force capable of going toe-to-toe with the Manchus, made up of Kyrgyz, Kazakh, Tajik, Kokandi, and White Mountain troops, 200,000 strong. He came down out of the mountains and took Kashgar after a 17-day siege. The Manchu defenders were either slaughtered or pressed into slavery, and it was the same with the Chinese merchants and the Altishari Begs who had worked with the Qing. Jahangir and his forces would go on to take Yengisar, Yarkand, Khotan, and Aksu, all oasis cities in the western Tarim Basin, and in all of which general slaughter was meted out. The Daoguang Emperor, Qianlong's grandson and the successor to the Jiaqing Emperor, well, if any of you are familiar with later Qing dynasty history, you'll know that this guy had both the worst luck possible and the worst ways of dealing with that luck. And Jahangir's revolt was only the first and perhaps the least of his woes. In retaliation, a force of between 70,000 to 80,000 troops, many of them allegedly Chinese Hui Muslims, was sent by the Manchu governor in Jungaria to quash the rebellion. According to H.W. Bellew, an Indian-born British officer who wrote at length on Afghanistan and the Tarim Basin, the armies of the Qing and Jahangir, instead of fighting one another, elected to send forth champions to decide the contest instead. Quote, "That of the Chinese was a giant Kalmyk archer fantastically dressed like a devil dragon, whilst the champion of the side of Jahangir was a noted Kokandi warrior equally versed in sword and rifle practice and clad in gaudy silks and chain armor. The two advanced to the contest on the open plain, backed by their respective supporters. But whilst the Kokandi was adjusting his rifle, the Kalmyk shot an arrow through his chest and out between his shoulders, and his adversary fell dead on the spot. A skirmish followed between the supporting parties, but the Kashgar army, disheartened by the untoward commencement of the contest, soon fled in disorder. They were pursued with great slaughter and loss in captives." Unquote. Jahangir then fled to his mountain base, but was soon betrayed, allegedly by a close friend to the Chinese. He was then taken to Beijing in chains and executed with the cruel method of death by a thousand cuts, Ling Qi, in which flesh is slowly and methodically cut from the body, sometimes over a period of days. The Manchu authorities, furious at Kokan's hand in the rebellion, boycotted all trade going to or coming from the Khanate. Troop levels in Kashgaria were increased, and money was confiscated from local Turkic and Kokandi merchants to aid in the construction of stronger fortifications in Kashgar, Yarkand, Aksu, and other settlements that had rebelled. But the most notable consequence of Jahangir's rebellion was that, as a punitive measure, Han Chinese settlers, not just merchants, could set down roots in Altishar. Remember, previous to this, the Tarim Basin had been closed to Chinese settlement. But now, all bets were off. And gradually, little by little, the Han Chinese presence in the region expanded as immigrants, mostly from the northwest, trickled in search of new opportunity. The government rented land to these new arrivals, and Chinese quarters began to crop up in cities like Kashgar and Yarkand. And notably, the Manchu authorities made no efforts to reinforce the defenses of the native Turki wards of these cities, rather focusing their efforts on the newer, predominantly Han areas. In all, Jahangir had only been the lord of Kashgaria for a handful of months. But that was not the last of the troubles that the Qing would have from the Hojas. Until the 1860s, rebellions led by descendants of the White Mountain would flare up every decade. Jahangir's own brother, Yusuf, raised his flag in rebellion in 1830, a mere 4 years after Jahangir's untimely demise, on the pretense of lifting the Qing embargo on Kokand. The Kokandis were gunning for revenge and redress of their humiliation, and Yusuf's band was mostly made up of disgruntled Kokandi merchants and generals of Kokand's army. The fighting was fierce, but this time the invaders faced a brutal resistance from the Black Mountain. Remember those guys? Well, they had allied themselves with the Qing, and were none too pleased with the White Mountain revolts, though murderous Chinese merchants did not really distinguish between the so-called good Muslims and bad Muslims. In the end, the Qing stronghold in Kashgar never fell to the invaders, and rather than dragging out the fighting, the two sides, Kokand and the Qing government, decided to negotiate a settlement. By 1832, the Qing campaign against Yusuf Hoxha had already cost the empire 8 million ounces of silver, not to mention a great loss of life. And so Beijing was more than willing to talk. The treaty that came out of it all stipulated that the Altishardis who had supported Kokand would be pardoned, and Kokandis would be allowed to trade in the region tax-free. That way, trade could go on smoothly, and the tensions between the two powers could be significantly diffused. And more or less they were, for a while at least. But although Kokand had tapped out of the struggle for Xinjiang, that didn't mean that the Hojas had. Although all was quiet on the Western Front for about a decade or so, in 1846, the seven sons of Jahangir, all of whom had been raised in Kokand, once again rallied their Kyrgyz allies and marched on Kashgar in what would be called the Revolt of the Seven Hojas. But this revolt, too, was quashed without much fanfare, though there was the, by now, requisite slaughter of both Han Chinese and Muslim locals. The seven sons of Jahangir were out of the picture. But the Afakis continued to harass Kashgaria in the person of Hoja Wali Khan, who launched raids on Kashgar in 1852, 1855, and 1857, all unsuccessful. Wali Khan's last rebellion in 1857 would go down in history as the most infamous, for Wali Khan had a nasty reputation for brutality. For 77 days, he besieged the citadel of Kashgar unsuccessfully, but in that time he managed to amass a large harem of both local and Chinese women and went about in a stupor induced by bong, basically a weed smoothie. He even erected a minaret of skulls on the banks of the Kizil River, the pièce de résistance of which was the head of Adolf von Schlagenfeit, hopefully I said that right, a German scientist and explorer who Wali Khan had suspected of being a Chinese spy and beheaded. When Manchu reinforcements finally arrived from the north, Wali Khan fled back to Kokand. There, the Khan of Kokand was only stopped from beheading the Hoja by the intervention of an ulama, an Islamic scholar, who pointed out that Wali Khan was a Sayyid, a descendant of the Prophet Muhammad himself, and could not be touched. Safe to say, the Prophet probably wouldn't have claimed him, as a great number of the people who Wali Khan had slain were fellow Muslims. And it was for this reason that the Kashgaris became disillusioned with the Hojas. Although many Uyghurs nowadays have lionized the Hojas, touting them as valiant freedom fighters, the Kashgaris of the time despised Wali Khan for his brutality and pillaging, which only caused a Chinese reprisal in the form of yet another general massacre of Kashgari Muslims. The Hoja uprising of 1857 would be the last, and the Hoja cause would gradually become irrelevant and then forgotten. You've got to keep in mind that, although there were a number of uprisings and rebellions during the first century of Qing dynasty rule in Xinjiang, these were mostly limited to the western end of the Tarim Basin, in the area of Kashgar and Yarkand. The Tarim Basin as a whole never rose up, even when the Hoja rebellions might have provided the opportunity. Contrary to many accounts, the inhabitants of the region did not resist Qing rule constantly. The World Uyghur Congress on their website claims that the peoples of the Tarim Basin revolted against the Manchus 42 times, all for the purpose of, quote, regaining their independence, unquote. This is very simply not the case. For the first century of Qing rule, things were more or less stable. Agriculture was expanded, both in Jungaria and in the Tarim Basin, and the economy was bolstered by the growth of both local and long-distance trade. But the 1850s would signal the end of these relatively stable times. China had changed. The First Opium War, fought between the Qing and Great Britain between 1839 and 1841, was a humiliating defeat for the dynasty that struck a crippling blow to Qing legitimacy. An anti-Manchu sentiment spread like wildfire throughout the empire. The treasury, already fraying at the seams, was further convulsed by the massive 21 million silver tile indemnity that the British demanded the Qing pay them in the Treaty of Nanjing. A tile is more or less equivalent to an ounce, so 21 million ounces of silver in 1841 currency, well, you do the math. Let's just say that it was a hell of a lot of silver. Xinjiang, if you remember, was criticized for never justifying itself economically. Although there was agriculture and commerce, so vast a territory depended mostly upon subsidies from the central government and taxes levied on Chinese merchants, and the salaries of soldiers and officials depended upon them as well. And with the treasury groaning, and with the population of Chinese merchants in the region being significantly depleted by massacres during the Hoja rebellions, well, you can see where all this might be going. When soldiers don't get their pay, things start to get dicey. Morale was at an all-time low, starvation was rampant due to grain shortages, and soldiers spent much of their time in opium stupors. Officials began to sell their titles to the highest bidder. Debilitating new taxes were imposed to compensate for the lack of income coming from the central government, and foreign merchants, complaining about the lack of Chinese goods in the markets, packed up their bags and went elsewhere. But things only got worse. In 1850, the greatest of all threats to the Qing dynasty, the threat that brought it to its knees and very nearly destroyed it, rose up in southern China, the Taiping Rebellion. Hong Xuechuan, hopefully I didn't completely butcher that one, disgruntled at having failed the imperial examinations, was seized by a mystical vision that led him to declare himself the brother of Jesus Christ and rebel against his Qing overlords. For 14 long years, 1850 to 1864, the war raged, going on to claim between 20 to 30 million lives. During that time, the Second Opium War, which pitted the combined forces of Great Britain, France, Russia, and the United States against the Qing, would be just one further humiliation to the dynasty. The Miao and Panthei ethnic uprisings, the Red Turban Revolt, and the Punti Haka clan wars, all in southern China, in addition to the Nian Rebellion in northern China, caused further devastation, mass displacement, sickness, starvation, and death, sending ripples throughout the empire that would eventually arrive in the west in what would become the province of Xinjiang. In 1862, the provinces of Gansu, Shanxi, and Ningxia, all in northwestern China, were shaken by violence. Local Hui, ethnically Han Chinese Muslims, also known as Dungans, rose up in rebellion. The revolt was highly factional, with a number of rebel bands participating in the fighting and no overarching goal or even real cause. But in the end, just like in southern China, millions of people died either in combat or by sickness or famine, and as many were displaced. And in the course of the rebellion, Xinjiang was brought into the fray. A vast number of Chinese Muslims lived both in Dzungaria and in the Tarim Basin, having moved there either forcibly as part of Qing resettlement projects or willingly due to the promise of land and employment. Many Dungans served as soldiers in the Manchu military, or as officials in the civil administration. Since the start of the rebellion in the Northwest in 1862, tensions between the Dungans and non-Muslim Han Chinese in Xinjiang had been slowly but surely bubbling. In 1864, though, they would come to a rolling boil. A rumor began to circulate that the Tongzhi Emperor himself, the grandson of the ill-starred Daoguang Emperor, had sent out a secret order to Qing soldiers in Xinjiang to massacre Dungans throughout the region as a preemptive measure, preventing them from revolting as they had done in the northwest. The Tongzhi Emperor called the rumor ridiculous and flatly denied having ordered anything of the kind. But nevertheless, the spark that would light the powder keg had already been struck. The Dungan revolt in Xinjiang had begun in earnest. In June of 1864, Dungans in Kucha, their anxiety at an all-time peak, fed up with high taxes and all things Qing, raised their flag in rebellion, massacring local Han and Xibei Mongols. They were soon followed by revolts in Urumqi, Kashgar, and Yangisar. And although the Dungans had initiated the uprising, they were soon joined in their effort by the Turkic Muslims of the Tarim Basin. In the western end of the Tarim Basin, where there were fewer Dungans, Turks assumed leadership of the revolt, while the Dungans maintained command of the rebel forces in the east. Today, this rebellion is often cast as one of the signal moments of the Uyghur independence movement, in which the Uyghurs rose up with their fellow Muslims to oust the infidels from their homeland. But remember, at this time there was no unified Uyghur identity, or really no Uyghur identity at all. And while contemporary accounts of the events certainly cast them in the light of holy war, religion was not the sole motivator. The principal drives behind the revolt were economic hardship, rampant corruption, and misrule on the part of the Qing government. Islam, however, served as the glue that kinda held everything together. But everything would only be held together briefly. No strong candidate with sufficient authority could be found to lead the whole of the revolt. And as a consequence, things quickly fell into factional infighting, with each group touting their own pretender. And the makeshift alliance between the Dungans and the Turkish Muslims soon dissolved, neither side being able to trust one another. By early 1865, the bulk of the Manchu forces had been driven out or defeated on the battlefield, with some holdouts scattered across the region. In the west, all that remained were the ragged defenders of Kashgar's fortress, who were presently besieged by a fierce band of Kyrgyz mountain men that had already ransacked the city. The then Khan of Kokand, Alim Kuli, had been observing the happenings in Xinjiang with great interest. Finally, with the Qing in such dire straits as they were, in early 1865, he determined that it was the perfect time to strike. At the Khan's direction, a host nominally led by a descendant of the Afaki Hojas, Buzurg, rose east over the mountains to join the Kyrgyz besieging Kashgar. Commanding the army itself, however, was a living legend, a man who would go on to be both reviled and revered, Yaqub Beg. If ever there was a figure worthy of their own SRHP episode, it was this guy here. Lamentably, we must gloss over the many colorful stories about his past. Suffice it to say that he was an adventurer who had made quite the name for himself in Kokand as a shrewd leader of men. When the Kokandi, or Andijani as they were known at the time, when they rolled up to Kashgar, Buzurg was quickly sidelined, and Yaqub Beg assumed total control. The Kyrgyz were ousted from Kashgar and Yengisar soon after, but the Manchu forces were still offering stiff resistance from Kashgar's citadel, and all attempts to take it had proved unsuccessful. But time, and most importantly, provisions were running out for the defenders. Finally, Yaqub made a deal in secret with the garrison commander, who exchanged the safety of himself and his family for the fortress. The gates were flung open, and the Andijanis rushed in, massacring the Chinese soldiers and merchants hiding inside. The Qing officials, in a final display of defiance, blew themselves up with what was left of the garrison's powder stores rather than facing the cruelty of the besiegers. Kashgar was now completely in Yaqub's hands. By 1870, Yaqub had conquered all of the Tarim Basin, from Kashgar in the west to Turfan in the east, and by 1871, he had brought Urumqi and parts of southern Jungaria under his sway as well. Feeling secure in his position, in 1872, in the Gulbag of Kashgar, the fortress known as the Rose Garden, he declared himself ruler over a newfangled Islamic emirate centered in Kashgar and encompassing the whole of the Tarim Basin. Atalik Ghazi, he was called, the fatherly holy warrior, or Badaulat, the one with fortune. His regime would be one marked by violence, economic and political strife, the imposition of strict Sharia law, and intrigues by Western powers. But to know what happens next, I'm afraid you'll have to wait till next time, because that's all for this episode of the Silk Road History Podcast. Man, what a blood-soaked episode that was. And let me tell you, it doesn't get much better as time goes on in that regard. Once again, my deepest apologies for taking so long in getting this episode out. Again, I bit off more than I could chew, and all this time I've been trying to figure out how I was going to frame this whole thing. Luckily, I think I've got it down, and there shouldn't be any more two-month absences. Fingers crossed. If you've enjoyed this episode, I hope that you'll consider making a small donation to the SRHP on my Ko-fi page, Ko-fi, coffee, however you pronounce it. With Ko-fi, you can make a small one-time donation of $3, the price of your average cup of coffee. Believe me when I say that I'm not a rich man, and the cost of monthly hosting fees and scholarly books can really add up. Truly, any donation to the Silk Road History Podcast, no matter how small, would be enormously appreciated. If you're interested in supporting the SRHP on Ko-fi, I encourage you to visit ko-fi.com/Silk Road History Cast. That's ko-fi.com/Silk Road History Cast. And be sure to like the page on Facebook, follow me on Twitter at Silk Road Cast, leave a review of the SRHP on the Apple Store, and visit the podcast website at www.thesilkroadhistorypodcast.com for supplementary materials like a timeline, list of terms, and my bibliography. The Silk Road History Podcast is now available on most major podcasting platforms, including iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Google Play, and with this episode, will be eligible for availability on Spotify. So be looking out for that if you get your podcast there. Join me next time, my dear SRHPers, for the History of the Uyghurs, Part 3. This is Nathan Cherry, host of the Silk Road History Podcast, signing off.